Congrats. I really love it. It's also an album that I'm like, ooh, I like it even better on the second or third listen. Right. Like, that's pretty, it's pretty rad and really fun.
Well, thanks.
So, huge congrats.
Thank you. Thank you.
Did you approach going this time around, were you like, we're making a record and like, or are you just like making music and when the songs are there, you're like, it's time to make a record?
Yeah, I think it's always kind of been that for me a little bit. You know, it's like, I don't know, like, you know, I like to make, you know, write songs that I like. And, you know, I didn't really, when I moved to Nashville, it wasn't like I had this master plan to be like, I'm going to be an artist, you know, like I didn't really know that was going to happen.
Wait, really?
Well, like that's what I was doing in North Carolina. But like I got to town and it was like, well, whatever happens, like, as long as I'm doing music somehow is like cool, you know. I thought it was a little
Even,
bit
like the kind of singer that you are. I'm sorry to sound skeptical. I'm like,
yeah,
you're...
but I think it was just kind of like, I don't know, like what are the chances, right? Of like me being where I'm at now, or of anybody, right? But like me specifically, and you're thinking to yourself, like, what are the chances of like out of everyone that lives here and everyone that's doing thing, like the super small percentage of people that make it, just not working a regular job would have been, that was always the goal, is like, just do music enough to make money at it and have enough money to live a decent life was always the goal.
Have you ever listened to the podcast, How I Built This? It's about...
Heard of it.
It's really like this guy named Guy Raz interviews, like... super entrepreneur, like huge entrepreneurial success story.
Gary kind of Vaynerchuk types.
Yes.
Yeah.
And he always rounds the interview out with, was it hard work or was it luck? So I would add to that, like the trifecta for us is talent, hard work, luck.
I agree with the luck thing, but you could also say timing instead of luck.
Timing. I think especially in the music industry.
I remember, you know, I had been in town. I moved here in 2014. And then I got my, I guess I signed my deal in 2016, I think, mid-2016. Couldn't buy a publishing deal. Couldn't buy one. I mean, couldn't have gave my publishing away. I could have went in somewhere and been like, I'll give you 90% of my publishing. And it was like, no, the answer was no.
Stop it.
Oh, yeah.
I've never heard that story.
Multiple times. Like a lot of like,
What was the critique?
At the time, it was like, and nobody would say this, and I don't know this at all. This is complete speculation and maybe completely unfounded. But I think the time is, I walk in the room, or a super hot dude walks in the room. I mean, let's be honest, right? Let's be honest about it. And I'm not...
Well, we were in a bit of a pretty boy phase.
Definitely.
As a town.
Definitely we were. And so, like I said, it comes back to the timing thing that we talked about.
Fascinating.
It has to be... If it's not the exact right moment in time, people are scared of it.
Yeah.
Because their job, when it comes down to it, is it's numbers. And if it's not risk-based, it's achievement-based. It's like, okay, well, we got this song out, and it better go, and it better do this, and it better do that. Or I might get fired.
Right.
Because I was the guy that stuck my neck out for you, and it didn't work. Which is scary. I can't blame anybody for doing that.
I think that about radio, too. Like, of course, people aren't taking huge risks. Like, especially in that.
It would be
like
scary,
people,
man.
People want to keep their jobs. And
right.
You can kind of, like, I get it.
You can't, right. It's hard to step out of that comfort zone thing. So I would go in, and people had kind of were of the understanding that I wanted to be the guy that did the songs.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so, but that doesn't mean that you can't do both. I always thought. I'm like, why can't I write 100 songs a year and get 10 cuts and then do my own stuff, you know? And so I didn't understand. I didn't get a publishing deal until after I had a record deal.
Well, you showed them.
I didn't take it. No, I didn't take any offense, you know, to that. I mean, like you have to just be, you know, I always thought at least you have to just be uncompromising. Because if I'm not willing to change my thing, because if I'm... Let's say I go in and they go, okay, well, we need you to do this. And let's say I lost 100 pounds or 80 pounds or whatever it was and fit the thing and changed my songs and did this thing. By the time all that's done, it's something else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I can't beat the guy that's already won the race that I'm racing.
That's right.
If he's already crossed the finish line and I go, I got to beat that guy right now. It's impossible to do. It's already been done. You can't win a race that somebody's already won. You have to try to win the next race. You have to try to get a leg up for the next time the race comes along.
I kind of want to talk about middle of somewhere. It almost feels like a brand statement for someone that like
sure.
loves country and loves country
yeah.
people
mm-hmm.
is like acknowledging how special the small, unremarkable places are that mm-hmm. we come from.
Definitely.
But,
that was definitely the idea. I mean, you know, I've been in Tennessee now for, 7 or 8 years, I guess, which is insane to think about. And then, you know, when me and my wife got engaged, we bought a place. It's an hour from town. A small town. And just, fell in love with it. Fell in love with, the place. My neighbors are just awesome folks. And everybody that I've met there is just so great. But they're just like, you can tell that everyone's like really proud to be from this town that nobody that hasn't lived there has ever even heard of, and I would have buddies come out, because when you get to be, big time guy like myself, people will drive an hour to your house to come write with you, new artists. So if you make it,
that's
you can
right.
move far away and everyone will drive to your house. But so anyways, all joking aside, my buddies would drive out and, they would say, man, dude, you live in the middle of nowhere. I'd hear that all the time. You live in the middle of nowhere. So then in my head, it pops in middle of somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, huh, that is mm-hmm. an interesting hook. I like that a lot. And so I was like, this has to have been written before.
Yes.
Kind of thing, right? How is
this? It's begging to be written.
Right. How do you not write it? And just that whole thing is like where that song came from was like this feeling of being connected to this little town that we live in and the people that live there and how great. They've been to me and my wife and, the respect that they have for our privacy and like, they're like just have become protective even in a way it feels like of us a little bit, like they want to help us out and it's like they don't ask for anything in return. Nobody's like, dude, let's be buddies and give me tickets. And well, it's like they think it's awesome that we're there. And I feel super grateful to be there and to be like, to feel like a part of that community, to feel like people are proud that we live there because they are so proud of that place that they feel like, this guy would move here of all places, he could move anywhere, and that's where the idea for that song came from. It's really, for every little town like that, but specifically in my head was the little town that we live in.
Why is the album named Growing Up? I couldn't find it in a lyric.
I feel like I'm in this, transitional phase kind of life. But for me, it's been, getting to produce more on this album than I did my first two, or at least having the creative freedom more in the sense of, me and Scott did really great stuff together, but we butted heads a lot, and that made for some really great stuff. But there were times when I felt like maybe I didn't feel heard, when I really believed in something like he wasn't willing to give. And it's not like I had to cave, but it was like eventually you get to the point where like, okay, well, I got to get this record done. So, turned out great.
Yeah, yeah. It worked
out
really
well.
It
worked out really
well.
That
doesn't mean you don't try new things.
Sure. And it was, those were good times. I mean, we made some really great stuff and I had a great time doing that. But with Chip and Jonathan, it's been... it's a more open line of like, hey, man, let's maybe try this thing or this thing's not working, I don't think. And like, they're way more, and nothing against Scott. Everybody's got their own style. But it's like they've been just way more willing to go, let's go here, let's try this, or let's start over.
Ooh.
But we did a few things where it was like, we're pretty far down the road.
Oh.
And, I got to call Chip and Jonathan and go, hey, man, like, I just don't get it. Those are tough calls to
really
make,
hard.
Man, because there's a lot of
work. You've
already
spent money. They've already spent
sure.
a bunch of time.
And it's more of their time to me that's like, because you don't want them to feel like you don't. I want them to know I appreciate how hard they worked or how hard we worked to get to that point. But it's like, you got to be realistic with yourself too and go, okay, well, if I'm not feeling this thing, this is too big of a thing to just cave on or not make sure we put 1,000% in. And Chip and Jonathan have been great about that. You know, that's been one of my favorite parts of doing it is that creative thing that we get to bounce off of each other, which was a really great part. And so in this Growing Up deal, it's like there are songs that I have written and I feel like really fit in with, you know, this one's for you, or we see is what you get. And it's like, but I'm 32 now, right? You know, and I don't want to put the same record out 100 times.